A bibliography. This is not a list of approved books. These are books that have been written in the area of spiritual warfare or books that would help you. We have people that are here that are ministering to Indians. Had the opportunity of ministering to Indians in Canada and also to Apaches on the reservation. And you need to understand something of their animistic beliefs and backgrounds if you really want to help them. These people live in a lot of fear. And so there are books in here on different Indian tribes, Indian groups in America that are written by non-Christians that are in the list, but are very helpful books because they deal with the whole background of where these people are coming from. So we want you to know that. I want to mention some books that some asked me to mention, and then books that you cannot get out here. If you're going to get these books, you're going to have to send away for them. They're special books, and they're of significance. Number one, Ensign and Howe asked me to recommend his book. He comes to our conference. He's sick. This book is on a power encounter techniques. So if you're interested in power counting, it's called Counseling the Demonized by Ensign, and he was not able to come. Also, the Christian Publisher Association, they've asked, and the fact that possibly the pastor wrote the introduction to the Birch's book. The Birch's book, this book, is also on power encounter, techniques of power encounter. There are missionaries for many years in the Orient. What is interesting, there's a chapter in here, how to test the spirits, or how to test the spirit behind the spirit. So you may find this book very helpful for that chapter alone. Just some oldies are Macmillan's, The Authority of the Believer and The Encounter of Darkness. If you don't have those, I would encourage you to get those and add them to your library. We have a brand new book that just came out. I got it Monday or Tuesday and wasn't able to read it. There's possibly one copy of this book left. If you are a pastor or a theologian, this book is a must for you. Ed Murphy, Ed Murphy talked about Clinton Arnold, who is a professor at Talbot Seminary, who wrote this book on Ephesians, Power, and Magic. It's one of the most awesome books written, but it has an awesome price. It's printed in England. It's $32 for 170 pages. But let me tell you, it's 170 pages of dynamite. It's the best book I've ever read on Ephesians. There's only one copy left out there. But he's written a new book. Please be seated. He's written a new book that just came out, which is The Powers of Darkness, and it's The Principalities and Powers in Pauline's Letters. No one has done a book like this. Gone through the Pauline epistles that's come out yet, where he deals with Paul's dealing with principalities and powers, because this has been a real issue. You know, is it only a gospel issue? You know, and after the gospels, there's no dealing with the enemy and so on. This is written on a scholarly level. This is a very brilliant man. I know Dr. Neil knows him very well, and Clinton Arnold's book would be a worthwhile book getting. I would like to recommend for general warfare, if you're not getting Bill Gothard's bulletin, this is the newest one. I haven't had a chance to read it. It just came. This has the best material that I have read in here on iniquity. The Iniquity of a Father, how to deal with pages and pages of tremendous material, how to deal with the iniquity of the fathers that pass on to children. And we're going to get into children. But of the four, it's $15 for the four volumes of this magazine. I worked with him on the second volume, which was on dealing with those who are demonized. I think it was volume 2. It's one with the squirrels on the front. And that is just loaded with warfare. This one is about half warfare. And so it's just very well done material. It's called Life Purpose Journals, The Power of God in Us, and there are four of them in the series, and it's $15 for the four, and you can get it from them in Oak Brook. Here are some books that you cannot get in a bookstore. If you're working with animist people, or if you're going to go to Africa, you want to get The World of Spirit. It's in your book. It's written by Scott Moreau, and Scott is teaching now at Wheaton College Grad School, and he teaches there in the missions department. And this book is a textbook in Kenya, Africa. It is an excellent book on the African and his background. I highly recommend this book if you're working with anyone in animistic backgrounds. Also, they have on the table there the Filipino Spirit World. If you don't know anything about animists, and they're all over America, aren't they? And they're living in their communities, and they're practicing animistic practices here. If you don't understand animists, get the Filipino Spirit World. You can get it right out there. That gives you an understanding. The same spirits that stock the Philippines, I gave it to a fellow who was doing a counseling internship under me, and this fellow read it. He was from the Caribbean, and the same spirits that walk through the Philippines walk in the Caribbean. I just got back from Maui, Hawaii 2 weeks ago, and the people over there who are being terrorized by spirits are being terrorized by the same spirits that walk the Philippines. The lady in white with the cloven hoofs and all of this. The same, it's that book will just put you into where these people are that are living in fear of spirits. An excellent book. It's a together book, a companion book, and the name of the book is Tearing Down Strongholds with a Companion Guide called Worship and Warfare. This is excellent. It was written by a missionary for 30 years with team in the Philippines. I mean, in Taiwan. In Taiwan, there are more altars and shrines per people than anywhere else in the world. This is just an excellent, excellent book. Yes, sir. Weber. Okay. But to get this book, the place you get it is Missions Frontier in California. It's the only place I know where you can get this book. So if you want this, you need to write them. They have an 800 number, but it's like $7 or something. It's reasonable for the two of them. The companion book, Worship and Warfare and Tearing Down Strongholds. The telephone number is 1-800-647-7466. Just an excellent, you'll be thrilled with this. And then the last book that is a World Vision publication you must get from World Vision, that has a lot of interesting articles in it, is Facing the Powers. And so this book is not a book that you find in bookstores. It's a book you get from World Vision. It's also in California by Mark publication aspects. So I wanted to run through, and then there's one more. That's offered here, and we said it's the only one. This is probably the most complete anthology on Satanism that you can get, and it's available here. You can't get it in bookstores, but it is available here. And if you're dealing with a Satanist or you want resources, you got some kids in D&D who deals with D&D, who are resources for these people, where you can get more information or whatever, is in this book. It's just a worthwhile getting book. Also, a little bit later as we get to children, we're going to share with you what they're offering, we'll give you free. And then an oldie but goodie, if you haven't had this for devotions, Get Born for Battle by Arthur Matthews, the fellow who was the last missionary out of China. And this is just writings of his whole life, an excellent book, Born for Battle, 31 studies on spiritual warfare. It'll just warm your heart. Just read a chapter a day, keeps the devil away. It's just an excellent little book. We hope. When I do a conference, see if I can find my notes here. I got stuff all over the place. When I do a conference, I usually start off, some of you have heard me, I usually start off with a statement. It's made by one of our authors here. People may not live what they profess, but they will always live what they believe. Don't ask a man, if you want to find out what a person really believes, don't ask him. But watch him in a crisis. And his response will reveal to you what he believes about God and God's power. That is an awesome, awesome statement, isn't it? We make a lot of professions, but when push comes to shove, do we really stand? And do we really believe? The man who made that statement is Dr. Tim Warner, who's going to come here for a moment and just share his book that's out in print, and what is unique about his book, and why possibly you may find it helpful in your library. Dr. Tim.
First of all, that statement is a quotation from my major professor at college, Dr. Milo Rediger, and I don't know where he took it from, but these are the kinds of things that get passed on because I think they're true. My book came out of an invitation to do a lecture series at Fuller Seminary a few years ago, and so I had to put some of my thoughts in writing, particularly on the subject of power encounter in world evangelization. And as I then began to edit those lectures and adapt them somewhat to this country, it comes out as a sort of composite of spiritual warfare on an international basis. But I suppose its strengths is that it has the cross-cultural perspective, but that gives it an objective look at our own culture as well, so that we're not looking at it with the often myopic view that comes from a lack of an international perspective. So I suppose those are the strengths that I would see in the book. Someone else probably needs to speak to that better than I.
That is the strength of his book. If you know any missionaries, I would buy them Tim Warner's book as a gift. I was vice president of one of the largest missions in the world for 7 years before I got involved in the counseling center here. I travel with many different missions, doing seminars all over, and the missions that are missionaries who are washing out because they don't understand the enemy and what he's doing. It's a tragedy. And this book is an excellent book for missionaries. It's written on it's easily readable, but it has tremendous information for those that are dealing with other cultures. I would like Mark Bubeck to come and to share with us. Mark has written The Adversary and Overcoming the Adversary, which have been out for years and years, probably the two best-selling books in warfare. But Mark has written a new book, The Revival of Satanism. And I want Mark to come and to share why God laid this on his heart and why this particular book may be a real benefit to you.
I think many of you know that I was led into the study of spiritual warfare through an encounter with the Lord when I was praying about something that's been a very important subject to me since my very early years of ministry, which is revival, spiritual revival, which our country desperately needs and our world needs. And as I was pastoring toward the end of my pastoral ministry, the Lord just constrained me to write this book almost as urgently as he constrained me to write The Adversary many years ago. And I believe that it is a practical handbook for helping people to get a hold of what you can do about praying for revival. In it are those little prayers, which are, I thought I had a copy with me, but, oh, you have it in your, the prayer patterns for revival. And it gives a systematic way, using Nehemiah's intercessions and experiences in leading Jerusalem to revival and the kind of praying that that takes. So I hope it'll be something that Lord really uses in our culture to help spur us toward what I believe is coming. I believe God's going to breathe on us a great awakening of his grace. And may it be soon.
So if you read Mark's book, you see it's really a book on prayer revival, calling the church to pray. We have some extra material that you may look at, and if you want to copy it, you can, that we have here. One is The Battle for the Mind. These are handouts. These are studies for someone who is struggling with problems with the mind. Another one that we've done is Biblical Protection in Prayer. And this is new things, a lot of brand new stuff that we just typed up or just received from somewhere. We get stuff from all over. But you may want to look at that. This one is just awesome. Ed Sivoso, who Dr. Ed Murphy knows very well, Ed Sivoso, I believe, is the brother-in-law of Luis Palau. Ed Sivoso has designed a plan, and Dr. Murphy's going to share it when he speaks, on how to take our cities for God. It was so taken by Bill Gothard that he had Ed Sivoso go to his headquarters, make videos, and so for the pastor seminars this year, this video of Ed Sivoso sharing this plan, how people could take their cities for God with a warfare stance. It's just tremendous. And It's here. If you want to see the actual, we have it here, and if you'd like to look at it, it'll be on a table out there. Another thing is aftercare. What do you do after someone has come to freedom? You might find some material there. I grabbed everything that we had on animism in here. What do you destroy? What do you look for in a home? What should an animist get rid of? What shouldn't they get rid of? Some of that type of material is in here, and you may find that very helpful dealing with people from an animistic background. And then if you want to have a deliverance team, here is a questionnaire kind of thing that you may want to share with people. The next thing was really interesting. The other day, or a couple of weeks ago, I was sitting in the office and I thought, you know, I've read the Bible through so many times, marking everything with demons in it. Have you done that? You know, all the New Testament, all the Old Testament, doing Greek word studies, and I'm getting different computer programs that do half the studying for me. I just push buttons and out it comes. And I've been working on all of that, and I turned to Mark one day, and I said, Mark, you know, I know what demons do. I'm sure that there's not a demon passage in the Bible, except my wife found one I didn't mark. Can't believe it. About the goat gods, which was, I can't remember where it was, but anyway, she said, did you see that? And I said, I'm sure I did, but I didn't mark it, so I got the goat gods, I got that marked. But I said, I don't know what angels do. You know, in Hebrews where it says angels minister to the believers. So I went down to my good theological library and picked out all my books on Hebrews, and I looked, and you know what the authors told me? That angels minister to believers. And I thought, well, I wonder what they do. You know, they didn't have to write a book to tell me that. I already read it. But, you know, I went to an old standby, and I think of when you think of Dr. Fred Dickason, you think of his second book. But you may really have missed something by not, you want to get my picture down here? It's better that way. Angels, Elect, and Evil. And he has a tremendous chapter in here how angels minister to believers. Fred, do you want to come and just share these two books and how God is using these books?
Well, I hope he's using them well. The textbook, it's a crossover book that it means it's a textbook and popular reading. Angels, Elect, and Evil was published in 1975 by Moody Press. And the first half of it deals with good angels, ones who did not fall, second half with evil. Right down the middle, see? And it should have been two-thirds good and one-third evil, right? That's an in-house joke. Huh? But we deal with their nature, their creation, their activities, relationship to God, to believers, interangelic activity, rank, and number, and basically then the second section deals with Satan and demons, and that was my first publication on that. The second book, Demon Possession and the Christian, was born out of a concern for God's truth and God's people after having counseled for, at that time, I think about 15, 16 years with people who had been in oppression. And I was concerned because so many people were hurt by those who say Christians can't be inhabited by wicked spirits. And if you are inhabited by wicked spirits, you're not a Christian. What a put down. Instead of looking at the facts as they are, presuppositionalists, those who already have their mind made up, tell us what we can and we cannot observe. And My position is theology, chairman of theology at Moody Bible Institute, and our middle name is Bible. I'm chairman of theology, and I thoroughly believe the Bible is the only final answer for doctrine and for life. But I think sometimes the Bible doesn't give us all the answers that we'd like to have. You know, by the way, it says very little about heaven, but we're going to spend a long time there. We know the basics. But I think what I've tried to do here is show how the Bible helps us along this line. The first part of the book deals with some basic questions. What are demons? What's demon possession? What is a Christian? By the way, that's a section you might want to look at. What is a Christian? I think that could be very helpful. It's a section on that you could use in the matter of a discipleship and maybe even give to your unsaved friends. But then spiritual warfare on three fronts. Then we get into the center section of the book where it deals with what is the biblical theological evidence concerning can a Christian be inhabited by a demon? and I try to objectively deal with that, come to the conclusion that the Bible does not have sufficient information for us to make a declarative statement on the matter, and that we have to put together biblical picture and clinical pictures, like, can a Christian have cancer? The Bible doesn't say so, but you use the same reasoning processes concerning that as you do on the matter of can a Christian be demonized. We do it every day. It's just that we have such emotional bias against this that we cannot clear our minds to understand the truth as it really is. Well, I deal with that. And then in this third section of the book, related matters, how do we defend ourselves? How do we help people along this line? And encouragements. So I hope that you're able to benefit by those.
Thank you. I had opportunities when I was in mission to visit many Bible colleges, and I'd always go in the bookstore into the theology department, and the Bible colleges across America are using this book as a textbook on angelology, as far as I know. There's major schools all across the nation. I wanted to give you a definition, and I left it out, and it's a definition of a stronghold. You want to write it down. This is from Taking Our Cities for God, and this is from Ed Sovoso. Ed Sovoso is Luis Palau, we said, brother-in-law, who has a ministry of going in and taking a city. But this is one of the most unbelievable, super definitions for a stronghold I've ever read. Remember where to cast them down. This is it. A stronghold is a mindset impregnated with hopelessness. A stronghold is a mindset impregnated with hopelessness that causes us to accept, as unchangeable something that we know is contrary to the will of God. That's awesome. And you, in counseling, you get people that say, what? This is hopeless. I can't change. And yet God says they need change. They need to be about a biblical change. Okay, a stronghold is a mindset impregnated with hopelessness that causes us to accept as unchangeable something that we know is contrary to the will of God. Until that stronghold comes down, there's not going to be a biblical change in the life of the person. Well, we have an out-of-print book that's on the table for sale. In the bookstore, some asked if they had any Victor Matthews, and they said, well, it was all out of print. Well, Victor brought some books. And Victor, would you come and share? Here he is. Are they walking back and forth while I'm talking?
I'm sure you all realize that the real key to overcoming the enemy is not shouting at him, but the place of Jesus Christ in your life. This little book is written to show an individual what it means to give the Lord Jesus rightful place, what the truth means, how to implement it in your daily life. Baker has taken this off the market, but I had a private printing made. I have priced it at less money than you would spend if you went to McDonald's. You can buy it for $3. If you need a lot of them, write to me in Grand Rapids, and I'll send them to you cheaper than that. So use them in discipleship. Learn how to give them away to people. If individuals do not know how to put off the old man, how to put on the new, how to take their place in the heavenlies, how to be filled with the Holy Spirit, no amount of time that you give to working with them are they ever going to be free. It's only Jesus Christ by the Holy Spirit through the truth will make people free. So I've written a little book as a foundation to show people what that means.
It's not listed in the bibliography because we didn't know that it was available. So it's called Personal Success. Is it in there? Well, I didn't realize I put it in there. If we allowed Neil to talk about all his books, I wouldn't have any time left for the kids. But most of you are familiar with The Bondage Breaker, and most of you are familiar with Victory Over the Darkness. I will not let anyone come for counseling that has not read Victory Over Darkness, because I found it cuts down just hours when they understand their position in Christ. It just cuts through a lot of the teaching and the working. But there may be some of these other books. And the newest book, I know that you're probably not aware of, many of you maybe didn't even know it was out yet, and that's Release from Bondage. So maybe Neil could share something about seduction of our children and walking through the darkness, but make a little focus on this, the new book out, Release from Darkness. When Neil sent me the book for free, and I like books that way, so if you write a book, send me one for free. And I read it. I started reading it, and it was time to go to bed, and I was very upset because I hadn't finished the book. And I knew I had to go to bed. I had a heavy counseling schedule, and the next day I finished it. So I called Neil, and he was teaching up at Trinity, and he said that on that book, that the people who got the early copies had read the book in 24 hours. So Neil, would you come and just, where is it? I don't trust him. Good. These three. Seduction.
I've read them.
Yeah. Oh.
Anyway, thanks, Jim. Seduction of our children was spun out of a need that as I was talking to adults, that I realized that most of their problems originated when they were children. And so that really spurred me. I said, we got to stop this problem so people don't live 40, 50 years in desperation. And part of that was the research that we did in Southern California in the Christian kids, and which maybe Jim will comment later on. I had Jim come out and do a video series with us that accompanies this particular book. But I'm telling you, it's alarming what is happening. This is Christian kids. When you find out that 74% of those kids believe they're different from others, that Christianity works for other people, it doesn't work for them. That's not true. 71% say they're hearing voices. If they played a game like Dungeons and Dragons, 44% say they have impulsive thoughts to kill people. I mean, there's a battle going on for our minds. And unfortunately, our answer to it is clean up society. And I'm saying, it's not going to work. It's not going to work. The problem is not there. It's right here. And especially amongst some of our kids. And I think the classic scenario is a little child coming into mom and dad's room and saying, there's something in my room. So mom and dad go in there, look, honey, there's nothing here. And then they leave. Now, mom and dad, if you saw something in that room, would you go back in there? But you go back in there, kid. But anyway, and I said, we got story after story, illustration after illustration of helping a little child to know that Christ is in them and bigger than they are, and he can tell them to leave. And we're just seeing that happen all across the country. And if that child from that time knows that he has that authority in Christ and can resist the evil one, the rest of their life will be shaped by that confidence in the Lord. Walking Through the Darkness was another needed book because so many people today, desiring to walk with the Lord, next thing you know, they're paying attention to some deceiving spirit or caught up in some false prophet. But how does God guide? It's not a negative book. It's a positive book. I didn't want the title Walking Through the Darkness. I wanted it Walking in the Light because that's what it really is. I mean, I really sympathize with Mark over here. He wanted a book on revival, but the title wouldn't sell, they said. So, Satanic Revival. It's really a book on spiritual revival. So anyway, that was a necessary correlation because I'm deeply committed that we got to learn to walk by the Spirit, learn to walk in the light, and to realize there's some hardships out there for us. But it's a book on divine guidance and how the Lord is guiding our life, interfacing with the reality of the new age world that we're living in. And Release from Bondage really was prompted by pastors when I would share stories in conferences, and I get these huge letters from people. And they say, what are you going to do with those? And I said, well, I don't know. And it really came out of a need. It's one thing for me to tell you a story. It's another thing to hear it from their perspective. And I'm telling you, it has been a gripper of what these people have gone through. I mean, it's an emotional experience for me to reread this book. And yet, answers out of that thing. It's victorious. When I did my doctorate of ministry class at Trinity about 3-4 weeks ago, it's the first time I had this book out. It just came out. In fact, it was just sent right there for that purpose. And a few students, you know, halfway through the week said, wait a minute, these are Christians. I know, one's a pastor's wife, one's a pastor, and you know. And this, I hope it'll help people to realize this is going on in our churches and in all over our churches. When I do conferences and across the country, man, you can't believe the problems that we surface. And oftentimes the pastors say, I don't think we have these problems in our church. Oh, yeah, you do. But the beautiful part about it is that Christ is the answer, and truth sets people free.
When someone comes for counseling, I try to remember to give them a book called How to Worship Jesus Christ as a free thing. Our counseling center does not charge for those that come for counseling with a demonic problem. And so we give them this book. It's written by Joseph Carroll. It's now printed by Moody Press, and with John MacArthur doing the title. And then we've got another little book that I like to put in their hand. It is called Looking Unto Jesus. Because I believe that every attack of the enemy, one of the main reasons for that attack is to get my eyes off of Christ, onto my circumstances, but worse, usually, into myself. And when I start focusing in myself, there's no hope there. Is there hope within you? You know, my hope is not within me. And all of a sudden, the enemy gets my eyes in the wrong place, and I begin to sink. And so this book, a little teeny book, it's so powerful. It's just looking unto Jesus. When you have a heartache, look unto Jesus. And some scripture verses. It's a very simple little book, but it's been very helpful to those that are going through some real tremendous trials. Okay, the little one is Theodore Mund, M-O-N-D, and it's printed by Bible Light Publishers in Hong Kong. A trip to Hong Kong, you can buy one for a quarter. I'm sure a bookstore can, and it's not in the book, because I just got this. I don't believe it's listed in there. Tom White is not here, but I'm going to refer to some of the material in Tom White's book in dealing with children. It's a very practical book. Tom White will be here. He's just not here right now. Tom is coming in today. But this book you may find very helpful. It's got a lot of practical things in the back, how-tos, dealing with certain aspects and certain type things. I got a call asking if I would read a manuscript before the conference. And I said I would love to read the manuscript before the conference. And so the manuscript came last Friday. I was overwhelmed. We thought it was three of them, one for each of us, but it was just one for me. This is called A Handbook on Spiritual Warfare. It's 7 inches high. I did finish it by Monday. The author of this new book, it's not out yet. They hope to condense it a little and put a cover around it. It also doubles for one of those chairs that the kids don't quite reach. You know? Dr. Ed Murphy, would you come and tell us what will I find in this book? Come up, Dr. Ed.
Well, Jim, maybe you can tell me because I haven't read it yet. I just wrote it. And that's no joke. He really has received more of it from the publisher than I have, too. Well, it's called The Handbook, and I didn't put that title on it. I would never use the word The Handbook on Spiritual Warfare. Basically, let me give you the background to it. When I first got involved in so-called deliverance ministry as a missionary, it was really an involvement with my own daughter, which I talk about in my tape series. And then I got involved in another situation in which Dr. Dick Hillis, the founder of Overseas Crusades, my mission, was involved. And then I ended up on Biola Talbot campus before Neil Anderson got there, and got involved in some incredible power encounters, deliverance ministry with Biola and Talbot students, and even with some faculty, which no one knows about because I've never written about that. But I remember I got into all kinds of trouble. And probably some of it I brought on myself because I'm an impulsive, outspoken person. I don't mean outspoken in a negative sense, but I just, if something happens, it happens. And so I got called in by the faculty, by the administration right down the line, and about the fact that I was not supposed to be casting demons out of students of Biola and Talbot. And there were three things that were said to me that really struck me. One is one of the administrators said to me, Ed, were there any demons here before you got here?
I'm leaving.
No, I'm not going to talk long. No. Okay, I see. And I said, I didn't put them here, I just found them. And then the second thing was a meeting with all of the faculty in the theology department of Biola and Talbot. Again, Neil wasn't here to defend me at that time. And the third was a meeting with the Department of Psychology. And The result of that is I had to begin to go back and reflect on what I was doing, and then out of that came the tape series, Spiritual Warfare, which is, there are some out there. And I got a lot of requests then, and even a request from three publishers to take the tape series and to put it into book form. And I said, no, the tape series go so far, but I believe there are deeper issues that have to be dealt with. And what I am interested in is doing what I call a beginning definitive study that would deal with the primary issue that we faced in this whole area, which we call a worldview issue. I don't remember if you last year you were here when you heard Dr. Matthew speak so marvelously on the impact of the Enlightenment on our theology. Western theology is as much Enlightenment-oriented, unfortunately, as it is biblically-oriented. I don't mean to be negative, but that's true. And then, so the first section of the book deals with an in-depth look at the whole question of how you see reality and why, and how that filters out the spirit world. Then secondly, the theological section just deals with an overview, like many of the men have done, on the area of the warfare motif of Scripture, what I call the spiritual warfare dimensions of a biblical worldview, and deals with what Dr. Bubeck will be talking about this week, the world, the flesh, and the devil. And why can't you live the Christian life as you should because of these various problems? Then I go into a strongly exegetical section, and that was the thing I really wanted to do, because we were constantly being criticized that what we're doing is not rooted in Scripture. It's rooted in experience. And by the way, one of my first chapters, I take this contrast between experience and the Word of God and show that that is totally without any biblical foundation. There is no such thing as a knowledge of God apart from experience. And there's no such thing as a true biblical exegesis that does not filter through experience. And experience and the Word of God are never in conflict in Scripture. And this is what Fred told us in his book, but they harmonize. So I started really from Genesis, I went on through to Revelation. And when I ended up, Jim, I told Jim last night, I think I had 1,200 pages. And the publisher wasn't very happy with that. And most of it was an exegesis. And so the problem has been cutting it down. But I tried to deal with every major passage in the Old Testament. I had to take some groups of books together in the New Testament as to what is the biblical worldview reflected in statement. And if you don't know the background to the worldview motif and the power motif of the culture at that time, those statements are filtered out for our understanding. But I came out of it with a strong conviction. I'm going to touch on some of it tomorrow night. That what we are doing is rooted in Scripture, and it can be proven if we understand the context in which Scriptures were written, which was this spirit world worldview context that we have lost. And then the last part of the book is a practical section that could have gone on and on. But there I had a strong chapter on the demonization of Christians. It's the six major causes, usually avenues, and this is transcultural, that bring demonic powers into the lives of believers, before they're believers or even after they're believers. And then one of them particularly I focused on was the area of child abuse, which I know all of us are involved in counseling, and I gave some heartbreaking studies in that area, but trying to hold before the people of God that the children of today are being destroyed for tomorrow, and unless we can reach the children and adult survivors of this complex situation, unless the church knows what is going on, we're going to have an awful time in the days ahead. And then finally, I went into some sections that I think are crucial to all of us, the relationship between so-called psychological, mental, emotional problems, and demonic problems. And I used some case studies in there and ended up with what I call the way of victory in spiritual warfare. So it's a textbook style that has a double focus towards the thinking critical leader and scholar, but it's filled with so many case studies that it can be read by lay people who have a grasp of Scripture and an openness to the Word of God. So that's basically what it's all about.
I've never read a book on warfare that goes through book by book by book of the New Testament with everything in the book, in that book that deals with the enemy, dealt with as he's done in this book. It's really an awesome book. We have a couple of free things for you. One is A Hard Look at Satanism, and this is written for the teenager. And the author is here, and he's made these available, and they're Bart Larson, and they're at the table where the book on Satan is, so everybody can have one of these. And then I don't have a lot, but if you're working with children, when I was at CEF, I asked, why don't we design a track on warfare for children? So we did design a track, and I didn't know if you've seen it. A lot of people don't even know what's out there, but there is a full-color track for children. It's a very simple track, just warning them about the enemy. And so that will be on my table with the resources, and you can look at that. We just have a